Kingdom. Briefly, I will run through how to access revision notes and test in Clay6.com. Go to Clay6.com. I have already opened here. Click on the practice. Then you will select, you will see a series of package. Now I am selecting NEET Premium. So if you do this, you will see select a subject. For all the three subjects, you have the packages and NEET full test, which are 38 in number. Now, if I click on biology, you will see chapter wise tests being in the form of bubbles. The bubbles, what you see in different colors are different tests. They are all graded depending upon the complexity of the lesson and also its importance in the NEET paper. Now, today we are going to talk about when I'll tell you the details about the test when we get into the test mode. Or, okay. Now, if you look at a pop-up here, there is a revision notes. If you click this, your revision notes will pop up. And that revision notes is what I have already clicked because I didn't want to waste time in scrolling to show you. If you do that, you will get a PDF. This PDF is of immense value because for all the three subjects for 11th and 12th, we have concised it and put it in a framework so that it's easier for you to revise and you can save a lot of time not looking at many unwanted things. What is needed from NEET point of view has been given here. Now you might be wondering what are the different kinds of questions that might arise in NEET because you might be appearing for the first time. Mind you, I tell you, you must have heard it from all your seniors or people who are very successful saying NCERT is the Bible as far as biology is concerned. Yes, NCERT is the Bible as far as NCERT is concerned. You will be getting 68 to 70 questions in the examination directly from the NCERT books. They can be attempted easily by those who read NCERT syllabus religiously. So you don't have to refer to so many books. I know there are many books in the market. People will give you hundreds of suggestions to buy this book, that book, and they are all bulky and voluminous. Please don't do all those things. Just stick on to your NCERT as a holy grail. Now, direct from previous year's question papers, another 8 to 10 questions in the examination with modifications or without modifications will come from your past papers. So it is better you have a hang of past papers, you work out and you practice it, for which we have also made a provision. In our test, you will also find past papers also meticulously solved by the tutors with solutions. And we have also explained how we have arrived at that solution. And modified questions. So at least 8 to 10 questions in the NEET will be newer questions. These questions become the game changer for those as they can't be solved by mere mugging up of facts. Though they are all from NCERT, to get them right, you need to apply the knowledge you have about the subject. So again, I'm telling you, in this website, we have made an earnest attempt to help people to get through NEET with high scores. Now let me get back to the lesson. Today, I told you it's plant classification. The weightage for plant classification, the 6 questions are going to feature in the paper. Around 5 to 6 questions, you can definitely expect. Now, most of the students become panicky. My own students, they ask, should I read extra lessons, extra topics? Nothing. Because he has seen to that, he is you're giving the questions only from the textbook. But one thing is, you had to get used to the words they try to ask in the questions. You should be familiar with the diagram. So these are the little things that will really help you to practice and get good marks in NEET. As far as this lesson is considered, now plant kingdom and animal kingdom, if you look at it, they are it's an ocean. Even at the level of master's degree, we will be reading it and at in-depth. But you don't have to. Some of your private books would have given you so much of knowledge. It is so baffling and confusing. You really feel jittery. Please don't do that. Relax. Now, this PDF will really help you in a nutshell. And I have also, in this PDF, we have not included the diagrams, but I am showing you, projecting you as the slides in the diagrams. If you have your textbook, you please make a note the kind of suggestions or what kind of questions will appear from this as and when I am seeing. I know it is nothing there much for me to explain to you. It is all the facts and why it is, it is. It is not like where you can analytically question. I'll try to make this session as interesting, looking mostly into how questions are being asked in your entrance examination. So now here I start with plant kingdom, that is plant classification. So in this kingdom Plantae, earlier blue-green algae and cyanobacteria were kept. But now they are removed and placed under kingdom Monera. So under kingdom Plantae, algae, bryophytes, pteridophytes, gymnosperms and angiosperms are included. Now let us look into some of the concerns that influenced classification system. The earliest classification systems were based on morphology. So if you look at it, it was all based on morphology and andrician structure and most of the vegetative characters. And this system was artificial system of classification. But this was proposed by Carl von Linnaeus. But we need to acknowledge him for initiating classification of angiosperms. The artificial system also gave importance to vegetative characters and reproductive characters, but it is a biased system, as you know that vegetative characters can get modified by the environment. So the next stage saw the advent of natural system of classification. So in the natural system of classification, it was based on natural affinities among the organisms. It took into consideration ultrastructure, anatomy, embryology, and phytochemistry. It was proposed by Bentham and J.D. Hooker. Now, when they came out with this, it was better than artificial system because it took many aspects into consideration, both external as well as internal features. Then at present, we follow a much more comprehensive system which takes into account natural classification along with evolutionary relationship. And this is called phylogenetic system of classification. Phylogenetic means taking into consideration the evolutionary relationship in establishing the classificatory orders for different organisms, the classification hierarchy for different organisms. And this system is known as phylogenetic system of classification. Apart from Hutchinson, many others have also come out, like Engler and Prandtl, Thakurjan system, Cronquist system. They are all phylogenetic in nature. Now let us look at latest branches of taxonomy. You know that as science and technology has advanced and we find computer playing a very important role, the softwares are developed, you can see its presence everywhere. So computer softwares have also been employed in our taxonomy. So numerical taxonomy is one. This has a database of various characters and for a given event its classification. And this is done with the help of computers, wherein number and codes are all assigned to the characters and then the data is processed so that maximum matching is done to place an organism. The next is taxonomy. See, it's not only the computer field that has evolved, even cytogenetics and cytobiology has also evolved due to the advancement in the tools that are available, as a result of which even cytological information is being used and processed to classify an organism. Now next you have the, and here you also gave importance to chromosome number, structure and behavior of chromosomes. Chemotaxonomy is based on the chemical constituents. So chemical constituents are also taken as a parameter for classification. Now with this background, now let us learn about algae. So algae, you know, it belongs to the division Thallophyta. Thallus means it is an undifferentiated plant body. Thallophyta means the group which has got plants that are whose body is made up of thallus. So the thallus may be unicellular, colonial or filamentous. They occur in wide range of habitats. They range from microscopic unicellular forms like Chlamydomonas to colonial wallworts or filamentous zoolotrix or Spirogyra. And you find very huge, that runs for 30 kilometers also, or 30 meters and 30 kilometers, like seaweeds or the sea kelps. Now, the major carbon dioxide fixation in the ocean is by this algae. Now let us look at the classification of algae. You don't have to get into six classes classification. There are many who have given us different classes, but stick on to your NCERT book and just look at these three classes. Chlorophyceae. Chlorophycean members are all green algae with chlorophyll A and B. Cell wall is made up of cellulose and pectose. They have pyrenoids in the form of starch. So starch is a reserve food material. Example is Chlamydomonas, Volvox, and Spirogyra. Now let me show you this a slide where you will be able to see the forms that are very important. So I'm sorry, here you find chlorophyce. It's a green algae. So here you can see Volvox, Chlamydomonas, and Chara. See, these diagrams are there in your textbook. So if you look at Volvox, it is a colonial form. The individual cells of So it is showing Volvox. So when you are seeing Volvox, it has got a small chlamydomonas structure. What you are seeing like this only, you will find them in a colony, and that forms the Volvox colony. So in your exam, they can ask you either of the diagrams and ask you to identify what is A, B, and C. See, generally we tend to overlook these details. Please have a look. This colonial form is a Volvox. Single cell, it is a chlamydomonas, and this is a Chara. It is more like a plant. And then look at the daughter colonies. The small rounded structures are the daughter colonies, and the outer covering is the parent colony. And then you find Chlamydomonas, it is only flagella, so that they will not ask you in the exam. But branches and axes, so they might only give you this Chara diagram and give A, B, C and ask you to identify the name of the organism and branch or the axis. So it is a very simple diagram, but please make a note of it. Now Paleophyce, brown algae with chlorophyll. So all brown algae are placed under Paleophyce, and chlorophyll A, it has got chlorophyll A, C and fucoxanthins. Because of these pigments only, these classes are made in algae, and the presence of predominant pigments impart the color to the algae. Now if you look at the cell wall, it is made up of cellulose and lignin or gelatinous coat of algin. Now mannitol and laminarin are the reserve food materials. Now example is Ectocarpus, Fucus and Laminaria. Now let us look at the Paleophyce slides. See, Laminaria, Fucus and Dictyota. These are the three things that are given under brown algae. Now here, this each and every part you have to remember. Here this is like a leaf-like structure because it is a slightly evolved class. So it has got a frond, it is called as a frond. This is a stipe, and holdfast helps in anchorage. Now if you look in Fucus, it is air bladder, frond, midrib, holdfast. So they can ask you this diagram A, B, C, D, identify the parts. So you have to be prepared for that. Midrib is something that is in the middle of the leaf-like structure. Frond is the leaf-like structure, and air bladder is that small circular structures. What you see is the air bladder. Holdfast is the one which helps in anchorage. Then next is Dictyota. Again, it is made up of fronds and stipe. They might ask you either this, or one thing is they can give different kinds of algae diagrams and ask you to place it under proper groups. So that you have to identify A, B, C. So these are the ways they can question you. And another important thing is, next one is Rhodophyce. That is the brown algae. Red algae with chlorophyll A and D, and R phycoerythrin, found on the surface as well as in depths of ocean. Cell wall is made up of cellulose fluoridein starch, And Floridian starch is the reserve food material. Example, polysiphonia, porphyra, and gelidium. See here, the most important thing in these things are the algal pigments that are very important. Reserve food material is very important for all the three classes. You had to make a note. And this is rhodophyce. It's a red algae. It is made up of porphyra and polysiphonia. They might ask you, along with this, they will give you some other plant, angiospermic plant, and then they will ask you to identify. That will be a little confusing because you should be clear with polysiphonia. And then they might give you some angiospermic plant and ask you to identify which is A and B. So learn these diagrams. So these diagrams are from the text and it is imperative that you learn them thoroughly. Now let us look into the commercial use of algae. Carbon dioxide is mainly fixed by algae for photosynthesis. Most important primary producers in the ocean. Species of Porphyra, Laminaria and Sargassum are used as food. Marine brown and red algae produce algin and carrageen respectively. That is, brown algae will produce algin, red algae will produce carrageen that are used commercially. Gelidium and Gracilarium species, they belong to red algae. They give agar agar. You must have seen in the laboratories, especially in the microbiology laboratories, wherein for plating they will use a medium. And that media is obtained from agar agar. It is agar agar, which is obtained from Gelidium and Gracilarium. Chlorella and Spirella. Spirulina are unicellular algae, which are rich in protein and are used as food supplements. If you remember Rakesh Sharma, who was the first Indian astronaut, he too used spirulina in space to meet his protein requirements. And now this ends about algae. So in your book, you have studied so much. Now if you look at it, it has all been promoted to such a short thing. Now even if you look at reproduction, that also they will be asking you. So we have put it as a separate table. So vegetative reproduction in chlorophyce is by fragmentation. Asexual reproduction is by flagellated zoospores. Sexual reproduction is by isogamy, anisogamy or oogamy. So this is in chlorophycean members. Now I hope isogamy means it is the fusion of two morphologically similar gametes. Anisogamy is two dissimilar gametes. And oogamy is an extreme isogamy, where the male gamete is small and reduced and motile, whereas female gamete is large and non-motile. Now, Paeophysi, it is the brown algae. Vegetative reproduction is again by fragmentation. Asexual reproduction is by biflagellated spores. So see, in Chlorophysi, it is flagellated zoospores. In Paeophysi, it is flagellated, but specifically biflagellated zoospores. And sexual reproduction is by isogamy, anisogamy, or oogamy. In Rhodophysi, it is fragmentation. Asexual spores, non-motile spores. And in Rhodophysi, it is non-motile gametes. So this is about it, and I have also discussed about the importance of algae, which is highlighted here. So within 2 or 3 minutes, you will be able to revise the entire information, what is required from the exam point of view from this PDF. Now let us go to division bryophyta. Bryophyta have root-like, stem-like and leaf-like structures. So they show a slight differentiation when compared to thallophyta. But they also lack true root, stem and the leaves, and they are also non-vascular. That means they do not have water conducting and food conducting tissues. These are known as amphibians of the plant kingdom because these plants can live in soil but need water for sexual reproduction. The predominant plant body is the gametophyte. So if I'm talking to you about gametophyte, please understand it's a haploid in nature, and when I say sporophyte, it is diploid in nature. Bryophytes have multicellular sex organs. That is, antheridium is the male sex organ and archegonium is the female sex organ. Antheridium releases male gametes, the anther zooids, in water, which comes in contact with archegonium. An anther zooid fuses with the egg to produce the zygote. Zygotes do not undergo reduction division immediately. They reproduce a sporophyte. This sporophyte is dependent on the gametophyte for its nourishment. Some cells of the sporophyte undergo meiosis. to produce haploid spores which germinate into a gametophyte. Now let us look into the classification. You had to know only two, liverworts and mosses. They are called liverworts because the body looks resembles like the lobes of the liver and human liver, and it is a thalloid body. Again, you don't find the differentiation into root-like, stem-like or leaf-like structures. Dorsiventral, thallus is dorsiventral and closely appressed to the substrate. Now the leafy members have tiny leaf-like appendages in two rows on the stem-like structure. Reproduction, vegetative reproduction is by fragmentation. Again, we have highlighted here. Now asexual reproduction is by the formation of gemmate cups. These asexual buds detach from the parent body and germinate to form new individual. During sexual reproduction, male and female sex organs are produced either on the same thallus if they are homothallic or on different thalli if they are heterothallic. The sporophyte will be differentiated into foot, seta and capsule. After meiosis, spores produced within the capsule are released that germinate into free living gametophytes. See, for everything we have tried to put as much as possible in the form of graphic organizers to help you recollect during the exams, and it might be a little confusing if you keep reading in the exam from the textbook just like that. Now let us look into liverworts, that is Markentia. Now this is what is given in your textbook, female thallus and male thallus. Please make a note, this is very important. Here they will give two pictures. Then they will ask you to identify which is a female thallus or which is a male thallus, or they will ask you to identify, they will just give a picture without any name, either this or that. Then they will ask you to identify whether it is an archegoniophore or an antheridiophore. Or they will ask you to identify archegoniophore and gemma cups. So whatever it is, you have to understand. In female thallus, you have three structures. One is the archegoniophore, gemma cup and the rhizoids. Now rhizoids and gemma cup are same in both male thallus and female thallus, but look into archegoniophore, that is the female reproductive organ, and antheridiophore, that is the male reproductive organ. Look for the structures here. If you look at the structure, it is flat leaf-like structure, antheridiophore. Archegoniophore looks like a radiating flower. So make this distinction very clear in your mind, children. Now let me get back to mosses. This class as gametophyte is the predominant stage. Protonema is the first stage that develops directly from the spore. This protonema is a creeping green branched filamentous stage. Leafy stage is the second stage which develops from the protonema as lateral buds. Vegetative reproduction is by fragmentation and budding in secondary protonema. In sexual reproduction, Antheridia and Archegonia produced at the apex release gametes. After fertilization, the zygote will develop into a sporophyte, and this will have foot, seta and capsule. Capsule contains spores produced by meiosis. Example, Funaria, Polytrichum and Sphagnum. Now let me show you about mosses. Yeah. So if you look at mosses, I have shown you it is Funaria and Sphagnum. You just look at this gametophyte and the sporophyte. Here the sporophyte will be short-lived, but gametophyte is long-lived, and sporophyte is dependent on the gametophyte. Now this sporophyte will be divided into capsule, seta and a foot which is embedded in the leaf, and this is the gametophyte. So this gametophyte, what you see is the antheridial branch, that is the male gametes are produced in that. This is the archegonial branch where the female gametes are produced. Now this, whatever you have studied, we have summarized it, and this will just take you 2 minutes in the PDF. Now let us get back to the third division, that is pteridophyta. Now pteridophyta, so it is the main plant body in pteridophytes is a sporophyte, unlike the bryophytes. In bryophytes, the main plant body, what you see is a gametophyte, but in pteridophyte, it is a sporophyte, and it has got differentiated into two, root, stem and the leaf, and it is the first terrestrial vascular plants. Now small leaves are called as the microsporophylls, and larger leaves are called as the megasporophylls or the macrosporophylls. Sporangia produce spores by meiosis and spore mother cells. Sperms germinate to give rise to inconspicuous, small, but multicellular, free living, mostly photosynthetic thalloid gametophyte, which is known as a prothallus. Here too, Antheridium and Archegonium will produce male and female gametes that fuse to form the zygote. And so zygotes will produce multicellular, well-differentiated sporophyte. Now, heterospory. Here in pteridophytes, the first time you see heterospory, that is formation of microspores and the megaspores. And this has given way for us to the seed habit in the higher organisms, where you see especially well-developed angiosperms. So what is a seed habit means? Development of zygote into young embryos within the female gametophyte retained on parent sporophyte. And this is very, very important, and it is seen in Selaginella and Salvinia. So seed habit, a precursor to seed habit is seen in which organisms? They will give you many choices. In that, the correct choice will be Selaginella and Salvinia. So Lycopsida, it is Selaginella. Pteropsida, it is a fern. Spinopsida, it is Equisetum, is an example. This is very important. They might ask you this Equisetum picture and ask you to identify Strobilus node, internode and branch. So make a note of it. And Pteropsida, it is Salvinia. This they will not give you. Maybe they will give you along with Salvinia, Icornia, and they will ask you to identify what is what, which is A and which is B. So make a note of it. So now, if you look here, we have come up with the classification, we have put it. The details are not required for you. In some of the private books, they would have given a lot of details. Please don't bother yourself and getting to know all these details. Just know the class and the example, that's more than sufficient. Psilopsida, it is Psilotum. Lycopsida, Selaginella. Sphenopsida, Equisetum. Pteropsida, it is Pteris. Now let us get back to the gymnosperms. So gymnospermae means naked seeded. So they have well established root, shoot and leaf systems with vascular bundles. They can be seen as medium sized trees, tall trees and shrubs. They are naked seeded plants. They are also heterosporous, producing microspores and megaspores. The two kinds of spores are born within the sporangia that are present on the sporophylls. The reduced male gametophyte is called a pollen. The male produces pollen and female produces ovule. When the pollen grain is released from the microsporangium, they are carried by the air currents to the ovule. The pollen tube carrying the male gamete grows towards the archegonia in the ovules and discharge their contents near the mouth of archegonia. Following fertilization, zygote develops into embryo and ovules into seeds that are naked. Examples, cycas, pinus, cedrus, etc. are all the examples. Okay. Now, classification of gymnosperms is important. Make a note. Cycadophyta, cycas species. Gingkophyta, Gingko biloba. Coniferophyta, conifers. Netophyta, netum species. Just make, you don't have to get to know the details, because some of the game changing questions might be based on this. That is our hunch. Okay. Now in angiosperms, you know, they are the flowering plants with seeds enclosed in seeds. They can be classified into two classes, dicots and monocots. See, they exhibit double fertilization and triple fusion. This was discovered by Navastin. That is very important. I'm not going to get into further details of reproduction here, because we are going to deal it in depth in reproduction in sexual reproduction in plants. When I'm doing that lesson, I will touch upon this in detail. So at the moment, from this lesson, one thing is very important. What are the classes they can ask? Dicots and monocots. And who discovered double fertilization and triple fusion? This is very important. The scientist's name is very, very important. Now let us look into life cycles which are found in the band cycles. So one is the haplontic, second is diplontic, third is haplodiplontic. Now, what is the main feature? So gametophyte is dominant in haplontic cycle. In diplontic, sporophyte is dominant. So please remember, gametophyte means a plant body in which the chromosome number is haploid. Sporophyte is a diploid plant body. Now, haplodiplontic is intermediate-like stage where gametophytic and sporophytic stages are partially dominant at different stages. Now, if you look at haplontic cycle, example is Chlamydomonas, that is the lower forms of algae, diplontic angiosperms and gymnosperms, haplodiplontic bryophytes and pteridophytes. So in bryophytes, if you look, it will be haploid stage will be more dominant than the diploid stage. In pteridophytes, diploid stage will be more dominant than the haploid stage. Now, let me show you this in the diagrams. So this is the haplontic life cycle. So here you see that only the sporophyte is represented only by the zygote stage here. That is the 2N stage. So here zygote is the only representative of sporophytic phase. You will not find a free living sporophyte. Zygote will undergo meiosis, resulting in the formation of haploid spores. Haploid spores will divide mitotically and form the gametophyte. Free living gametophyte is the dominant phase. Wallwalk, Spirogyra, and few species of Chlamydomonas. Now, diplontic life cycle. So, as I said, that sporophyte, you just look at it. This pink color, what is shown as the gametophyte, it is very small. In the diplontic phase, diploid sporophyte is dominant and it is independent. The gametophyte is represented by single to few cells called the gametophyte. Example, this is seen in angiosperms and gymnosperms. The next is haplodiplontic life cycle. So if you look here, both phases are multicellular, but they are dominant in different phases. So for example, if you look in bryophytes, the dominant phase will be the haploid phase when compared to the sporophytic phase. That is, gametophyte will be dominant. In pteridophytes, actually sporophyte will be dominant than the gametophytic phase. So these diagrams are very important, children. They might ask you, for example, they might give you this figure. They might ask you to identify what cycle is this. And then they might have, they will remove this 2N and this process syngamy. Syngamy is fusion of the gametes. So this process they will remove. Then they might ask, or they might ask you what is this and what is the gametophyte. Like this, they are based by which they will test you. See, they are not going to test something which they assume that master's students or graduate grad at grad level or postgraduate level should know. But definitely they will look into your observation skills and your keenness in identifying. And that is how the questions are framed. So if you are thorough with your NCERT textbook, not only with the theory part, but also with your diagrams. That is why these two chapters carry 9 marks. That is why I'm insisting on the diagram showing you so many slides. As even if I put all these things in a PDF, that will not really reach you because you will tend to overlook it. For you, the reading material becomes very important. That is why we never put much of the diagrams, and I'm introducing you how you should look at a diagram, what questions could be framed. You should be able to do it on your own also, so that you are able to understand and process the diagram better. I hope you have understood about this lesson. Now let me take you to the test. So plant kingdom. So here, as I said, I'm going to talk to you about the different kinds of tests and what do these bubbles mean. So you'll find all the kinds of colored bubbles here. So these are the different tests. And like this, you have for each chapter different tests which are graded depending upon the complexity. If the content is too confusing, if the content you need to remember, then we will put in more number of tests to help you better. Now, if it is a green color one, that means to say that you have taken the test and the test is completed. Suppose in this score I have completed and I have got only 100 marks, 10%, I'm happy. Suppose I get only 70% or 80%. At that point of time, after 2 or 3 days, I might, after looking at the answers, might revisit the test. So even if it is in green, you are allowed to take the test any number of times. Now, if you look at the yellow test, yellow bubble, this means to say I started the test, maybe after 4 or 5 questions, I failed. I am not ready for the test and I would have come out of the test. I would have quit the test. So that shows that it is an incomplete test and I am supposed to complete it. So that is an indicator that I am not prepared. These are the things and areas I need to prepare myself. And then you will visit the test again. If it is blue, I have not opened the test at all. I am yet to do. If it is red, that means to say that it's a random test. So suppose you have completed all the 3 levels. Then if you want further practice, you can go in for this randomized test. So that's why I'm saying this is a value addition. I wish you all take up this package. It will be of immense help and value to you. Now let us look into the plant kingdom. So the members of Chlorophyceae are usually grass, green. Reason: green color is due to the dominance of pigments chlorophyll A and B. Regarding assertion and reasoning, both A and R are correct, but R is not the correct explanation. That itself is wrong. So we can eliminate this choice. So both A and R are correct and R is the correct explanation for A. So I'm going to click this, save and next. In Paeophyceae, union of gametes take place within the oogonium. So that is anisogamous species, isogamous, oogamous, all of the above. The answer will be oogamous because it is taking place in the oogonium. In Paeophyceae, union of male and female gametes can take place in water within the oogonium, both A and B, none of the above. It is both in water and within the oogonium. So these are the simple things which we tend to overlook when we are reading the textbook. But the sentence is there in the textbook. That is why I'm suggesting you take this package to help you better and prepare better for the exam. The common forms of Paeophyceae are Glaziraria, Laminaria, Porphyra, all of the above. It is Laminaria. The common members of Rhodophyceae are Spirogyra, Laminaria, Porphyra, all of the above. So here if you look at Rhodophyceae, it is Porphyra. Bryophytes are found commonly growing in hills, all of the above, in shaded areas, in moist areas, all of the above. Species of sphagnum, a moss, is used as a packing material for transshipment of living material. Reason: they have capacity to hold water. So that is true. Both A and R are correct and R is the correct explanation of A. Regarding liverworts, in the plant body of a liverwort is thalloid, dorsiventral and closely oppressed to the substrate. True. The leafy members have tiny leaf-like appendages in 2 rows or the stem-like structures. Now, if you look at the revision notes, we have made this very clear. So that's why I said why this revision notes is going to help you means when you are looking at it, look at this. So in these notes, you will be able to get the answers. That is why I'm repeatedly suggesting you that you take this package. So here both are correct. Pteridophytes includes ferns, horsetails, all of the above, none of the above. Both horsetails and ferns. The sporangia produces spores by meiosis in spore mother cell. The spores germinate to give rise to small multicellular free living, mostly photosynthetic thalloid gametophytes called prothallus. Now regarding 1 and 2, what is it? Here both are correct. Now gymnosperms include shrubs, tall trees, medium sized trees, all of the above. See, generally, if you look at it, gymnosperms means the mind to your mind, the Christmas tree will come, cycas, pinus, all these things will come. You will think it is the tall trees, but actually it is all. That is why you need to read in between the lines. Now, angiosperms include microscopic Ulfia, yes. Tall trees of eucalyptus, yes. All of the above, yes, both A and B. Regarding alternation of generation, choose the incorrect one. Spore producing diploid sporophyte, gamete producing haploid gametophyte, occurs in asexually reproducing plant, occurs in sexually reproducing plant. Occurs in asexually reproducing plant is the incorrect one. Regarding bryophytes, the incorrect one is prostrate, erect, thallus-like, none of the above. So none of the above. Plant body of liverwort is thalloid and dorsiventral. Plant body of mosses have upright, slender axis, bearing spirally arranged leaves. Now regarding one and two, if you look at it, both are correct. Both are correct. Now I'm ending the test. Now, if you look at it, all my answers are correct. Suppose I have not attempted this question, then it will show an unanswered in the legend. And then I can look into the question to know whether what is the answer. And if it is wrong, suppose if this one has come red, then if I click on it, then I will know which is the what is the mistake. It shows your wrong answer and your correct answer, your answer and the correct answer. So in this way, you will be able to check your errors and also rectify your errors. Thank you, children.